burning. Can I use this one?
Just check to see which one's on.
Good morning, everyone. My name's Sarah. I was here before. I was the crazy lady that was running around leading the rounds. Do you remember that? Because we're going to do a little bit more of that today. Okay. I'm going to say a prayer and then we're going to get started, okay? Dear Lord, thank you so much for this wonderful day, and thank you for the taste of summer we got this last week, and thank you that we're going to get some spring this week. And we praise your name, and we're just so grateful for the God that you are and that you love us and take care of us. And we ask that this song service would be a blessing to you. In Jesus' name, amen. So I always like to kind of do a theme whenever I'm leading something like this. And today we're going to be praising God with our senses. So with our hands, our feet, our eyes, our ears, and our mouth. I know those aren't the five senses, but you get the gist, okay? There are a few things I especially love about this time of year. I love to sit out on my patio and hear the tree frogs, birds, and crickets around our house. That's my sense of hearing. I love the cool breeze that blows through the trees and the sunshine that gives me sunburns. I love eating watermelon, corn on the cob, and ice cream cones. I love to water my garden and watch it grow. I like the smell of freshly cut grass, and weirdly, I also like the smell of gasoline because it reminds me of taking trips with my family. God has blessed us with our five senses so that we can learn more about him and experience his love in a deeper way. So this morning, we have an opportunity to praise him for all the blessings he pours out on our senses. So we're going to do a little bit of this today and a little bit of this. So I hope you guys are ready. The first, I actually do have a scripture, Psalm 19:14. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. So I'm going to need your help. The first song we're going to sing will be without the piano. It's If You're Happy and You Know It. And everyone knows that one. If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. If you're happy and you know it, then your face will surely show it. If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. If you're happy and you know it, stomp your feet. If you're happy and you know it, stomp your feet. If you're happy and you know it, then your face will surely show it. If you're happy and you know it, stomp your feet. If you're happy and you know it, shout amen.
Amen.
If you're happy and you know it, shout amen.
Amen.
If you're happy and you know it, then your face will surely show it. If you're happy and you know it, shout amen.
Amen.
If you're happy and you know it, do all three.
Amen.
If you're happy and you know it, do all three.
Amen.
If you're happy and you know it, then your face will surely show it. If you're happy and you know it, do all three.
Amen.
Good job. Thank you, everyone. All right, the next song we're going to sing is The Lord Jehovah Reigns, and that's in the Purple Hymnal 155.
Lord, the 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 Lord
last line of that. Join all my powers to praise the Lord. That's the goal today, is we're using all of our senses to praise the Lord. So I hope we'll do that this morning, especially with this next one. I love doing rounds, and I think everyone will know this one. I'm going to sing it through one time, and please just sing along if you know it. I think everybody knows this one, but we'll see. This is how it goes. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice, rejoice, and again I say rejoice. Nice, we know it. So we're going to split right down the middle. We got to keep up the tempo, though, everybody. Last time, one of the sides was dragging a little bit when we did one of the rounds, so we got to keep up the tempo. Mom, can you come help me? She's our lovely volunteer for today. you can be on this side, okay? All right, so we sing the rejoice part, and then they'll start singing the rejoice part as we're singing the second part. You guys know this. We got this. Okay? Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Rejoice. Done. All right. Oh, okay. I have a neat little story. This is, my grandmother gave me this book. It's Daily Guideposts. So it has these devotions and a prayer and a scripture for every day of the year. And I just love it because it's only one page. So it's very quick if you have a busy morning. Anyway, highly recommend it. I'm going to read one from a couple weeks ago. While I was sitting on Waikiki Beach, people watching, my attention was snagged by a young mother and her small child who spoke another language. I wondered if my English-bound communication skills might hinder any attempt to interact with the lovely pair. The mother kneeling along the walkway with her camera, the toddler venturing into the sand. Back and forth he went, each time returning to savor his mother's approval. As the mother offered him praise, I joined in, laughing, nodding, simply unable to contain myself as his smile and clasped hands communicated to me, I might not speak your language, but I'm so proud that you're pleased with me. While the writer of Psalm 19 extols the silent speech of the heavens, God's people are ever learning a language for the ages, daily taught by his Spirit, the language of love and servanthood, which I should have read this in Psalm 19, this is what they're referencing. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out unto all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. That was the different version than ours, but I still thought it was really pertinent. Okay, so just as God set the moon and stars in their courses, he set his Spirit in the hearts of believers to nudge us toward righteousness, guiding, instructing, and inspiring us as we learn to give him free course. The Comforter Jesus sent to us is not simply a lofty-sounding description on a page in Scripture, but a person of the Godhead who cares so much that he is grieved each time we fail to respond in love. Whether it's volunteering to rock a sick baby or quietly handing out a hot meal to an exhausted new neighbor, gestures of caring often outstrip the most eloquent sermons and the most jaw-dropping scenes in nature, and they speak as clearly as a toddler's smile. And this prayer, Lord, like the heavens, help me to joyfully and consistently declare your glory through the language of your Spirit. Next, we're going to sing Holy, Holy, Holy is the Lord, and that's the purple number 4.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Sing, O ye people.
I'm giving them a run for their money in the back. I forgot to read the scripture in Nehemiah 9:6. If you can pull that up, if not, it's fine. This is how it goes. Thou, even thou, art Lord alone. Thou hast made heaven, the heaven of heavens, with all their host, the earth and all things that are therein, the seas and all that is therein, and thou preservest them all, and the host of heaven worshipeth thee. Next, we're going to do another round because I just love rounds. It sounds so nice. We're going to do King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and everybody knows that one. So this is how it goes. King of Kings and Lord of Lords, glory, hallelujah. King of Kings and Lord of Lords, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah.
Well done. All right, we're going to split down the middle and we'll just sing it through twice, okay?
King of Kings and Lord of Lords, glory, hallelujah. King of Kings and Lord of Lords, glory, hallelujah.
Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah. King of Kings and Lord of Lords, glory, hallelujah.
King of Kings and Lord of Lords, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah.
Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah. Jesus, Prince of Peace, glory, hallelujah.
All right. Now we're going to sing one that everyone should know. And I keep thinking about our senses, using our senses to praise the Lord, using our senses to understand him better, and recognize that what we're doing in our lives each day is an example of how we should be, how we should treat each other, and that the Father's looking down on us in love. So we're going to sing, Oh, Be Careful, Little Eyes, What You See.
Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see. For the Father up above is looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see.
Hands.
Oh, be careful, little hands, what you do. Oh, be careful, little hands, what you do. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little hands, what you do. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. Oh, be careful, little feet, where you go. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little feet, where you go. Oh, be careful, little mouth, what you say. Oh, be careful, little mouth, what you say. For the Father up above is looking down in love. So be careful, little mouth, what you say.
Right, we have another scripture, Romans 14:17-19. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. For he that in these things serveth Christ is acceptable to God and approved of men. Let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace, and things wherewith one may edify another. Now we're going to sing Open My Eyes That I May See from the Purple Hymnal, number 208.
Truth thou hast for me.
going to share really quickly before our last piece here. I started reading a book. I can't remember the title. I should have brought it with me. It is about a boy who was born to deaf parents. Both of his parents are deaf. And he grew up in the 1930s and 40s. And the book is absolutely fascinating because he has his sense of hearing. And so he ends up helping communicate to the world for his parents. And back then, people who were deaf were looked on as not as smart as people who could hear. And so even navigating sign language, like that was, they believed that people who couldn't hear could still use their voice box and could learn to talk. So they, sign language was even looked down on back then. But the book is just amazing because of how the boy, the relationship that he has with his parents is incredible, and then how he communicates with them and how he helps communicate with the world on their behalf. And I wish I had the name of the book. I can bring it next week, or if anyone's interested, let me know. But it really makes me appreciate my sense of hearing, and being able to communicate with others is a huge blessing. And so I just happened to be reading that book when I was preparing for this. I was like, wow, well, I thought I would share that. The last thing, it's actually going to be a special music piece that we're going to project here. I found this piece of music. They put it online in April of 2020, and the significance of it, everyone was isolated at that time, and this group put a musical together. You'll see, you'll understand when you watch it, but ever since I saw that, that this song just keeps coming back to me all the time, and it's about God's love, and I thought I would share really quick just about this group. This is called the Voices of Lee is the name of the group. I don't know if any of you have heard of it. The Voices of Lee is a 14-member a cappella ensemble from Lee University in Cleveland, Tennessee. Since their debut in September 1994, their intense musical focus and their dedication to harmony, spirit, and performance have captivated audiences worldwide. So we are going to be blessed by listening to this as our last piece. So please enjoy.
You are here, moving in a mist. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every. I worship you.
so full. Even when I don't see you're working, even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop, you never stop.
£9 of fat in just a matter of weeks. Did you know every overweight person on earth has one?
Heavenly Father, you always amaze me. Let your kingdom come in my world and in my life. Give me the food I need to live through today. And forgive me as I forgive the people that wrong me. Lead me far from temptation. Deliver me from the evil one. I looked out the window. The birds are composing. Not a note is out of tune or out of place. I walk to the meadow and stare at the flowers, better dressed than any girl on her wedding day. So why should I worry? Why do I freak out? God knows what I need. You know what I need. Your love is, strong. Your love is, strong. The kingdom of the heavens is now advancing. Invade my heart, invade this broken town. The kingdom of the heavens is buried treasure. Will you sell yourself to buy this one you found? Two things you told me, that you are strong and you love me.
yes, you love me.
Good morning. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you, as always, Sister Fountain, for a wonderful, wonderful use of the gift that he gave you. Already this morning, we got to hear God speak when he woke many of us up this morning to the crackle and boom of his voice. Before I get to the call to worship, I want to introduce to you a friend of mine, a brother of mine, Elder Tyler Ramirez. He watches me almost die every 2 weeks here out on this basketball court while he runs circles around me with the other youth. Now, I'm calling 20-year-olds youth, but that's because I'm 46, so just bear with me in that. But he's going to be delivering the spoken word this morning, and I'd ask that you pray for him, that we'd impart those words that God would have you hear today so you may be uplifted and edified, and the glory may be God's. So call to worship today comes from Moroni, Chapter 10, 29 and 30. Yea, come unto Christ and be perfected in him, and deny yourself of all ungodliness. And if you deny yourself of all ungodliness and love God with all your might, mind, and strength, then is his grace sufficient for you, that by his grace ye may be perfect in Christ. And if by the grace of God ye are perfect in Christ, ye can nowise deny the power of God. And again, if ye by the grace of God are perfect in Christ and deny not his power, then are ye sanctified in Christ by the grace of God through the shedding of the blood of Christ, which is in the covenant of the Father, unto the remission of your sins, that ye may become holy without spot. We're going to stand and praise our God together by singing hymn 5. It'll also be on the screen for easier viewing. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty.
Oh,
Bow with me. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Spirit here, and we thank you for the beautiful weather that we have that is a constant reminder of thee and thy power and thy grace. We'd ask that your Spirit would continue to abide here with these thy people, that people would be uplifted and edified, and that your word would be manifested by our brother, that the glory would be yours. In Jesus' most holy name, amen.
I want to start out this morning by reminding everybody of the change jar we have up here for those who have change and would like to give for that. And I also want to share a little testimony growing up. I didn't grow up with much. I guess we had plenty, but we didn't have much money because my mom had to work a couple jobs. And sometimes it was got to the point where we didn't know, you know, what we were going to do next or where the money is going to come from to pay the bills. And I never really worried about that because I was young, obviously. But a memory that I have is that going to church, my mom always gave, no matter what the week looked like for us and how much we had. And she always gave from her heart and knowing that God was going to bless us with what we had growing up. So that's what I would ask that you guys would do this morning is no matter what struggle you're in, and even if it's only given a few pennies or some change that you have, God will bless your efforts and anything that you do, if you give with your heart and for the right reasons, that he will bless it. So with those collecting, please come forward. Would you bow with me? Our dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day you blessed us with. I thank you for the rain and for showing us your voice and for letting us know that you're there for us. I thank you for being with us already in this service, and I'd ask that you would continue to do that. And I'd ask that you would be with all of us in our hearts and touch us and show us that no matter what we have to give and to offer, that you will be with us and you will bless us and provide for us if we need it. I ask that you would bless the money given, that it will be used for a good cause, and that we will be able to provide for this church and for those families and members here, and also to provide for the community around us, and to do what we can to bring forth Zion. I ask these things in your Son Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Well, good morning. It's such a joy to be here, and I have a couple scriptures for the scripture reading this morning for your consideration. We come out of section 1 of the Doctrine and Covenants. It says, "But every man walketh in his own way, and after the image of his own God, whose image is in the likeness of the world, and whose substance is that of an idol, which waxeth old and shall perish in Babylon, even Babylon the great, which shall fall." And going down to 4C to E, it says, "The weak things of the world shall come forth and break down the mighty and strong ones, and that man should not counsel his fellow men, neither trust in the arm of flesh, but that every man might speak in the name of God, the Lord, even the Savior of the world, that faith also might increase in the earth, that mine everlasting covenant might be established, that the fullness of my gospel might be proclaimed by the weak and the simple until the ends of the world and before kings and rulers." Coming from Luke chapter 12, it says, "Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." Jumping down to 37, it says, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word.
And look at my feet. It's okay if it's hard to believe. I have faith that you will do greater things. It's my time to go, but before I leave, goodbye is not the end. goodbye is not the end.
Hello?
Okay, cool. One of my favorite hymns of all times is Blessed Be the Tie That Binds Our Hearts in Christian Love. As soon as I walked in here, I could just feel the Spirit. As soon as I saw each of you, though I don't know very many of you, that same Spirit that I know and that you know is among us now. And what a joy it is to be here. And I don't want to give you a spiel about who Tyler Ramirez is to give you some kind of background, because that's not the name I come in. I come in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And this morning I'm so filled with joy, if that makes sense. I'm filled with joy. I don't need the so there, but I'm filled with joy. Because this week before Paul had texted me and asked me about what the theme was, if there was a hymn that I wanted to sing, or if there was a scripture reading, anything like that. And typically I try to hold off on giving presiders the theme or anything else like that, because I want to see how the Lord works. But I understand that Paul is the presider and he'd like those things. But the Lord had a different plan, because as Paul can testify of, that it wasn't until yesterday, that I actually texted him. So all week, I don't know how Paul's preparation or his mind was, hopefully it wasn't anxious or anything. But what a joy it is, because right now I get to testify that the scripture reading, the call to worship that Paul has brought to you this morning, is the same scripture that I will be reading out this morning. And the same special music that Margaret sung about was about the kingdom of God. And in Colin's prayer at the end, he said that we might be able to build up Zion. Holy, holy is our God. I can sit down. But praise be unto him. There's nothing that I can say or nothing I can do but be by his name. And the same for all of us as a body. This morning I was reminded of a dream that I had when I was a kid. And as a kid, I wasn't really close to the Lord. I didn't understand my relationship with him or the relationship that he wanted to have with me. But he gave me a dream when I was younger. And I was in my hometown of San Diego. And I was on the corner of the street that we grew up on. And I was on the corner with my scriptures. And back then, when I was a sixth grader, I can't remember if it was sixth grade or in high school, but I can tell you what, I didn't read my scriptures. But I was on the corner with my scriptures. And I was preaching the gospel. I was telling my city of Zion. And this morning, the Lord had reminded me of that dream that I didn't even know was spiritual. But as my preparation since January, the Lord has led me to go back to my hometown and bring the gospel. And I've been there plenty of times. I've been there so many times. There's been so many baptisms and people coming to the gospel. But I asked the Lord, what is the message that you would have me give? And back in January, in my preparation over the months till now, I didn't even realize it. But it was the message of Zion. And so, brothers and sisters, I'm not saying that Zion's going to come in the summer. Zion's going to come this year, next year. But brothers and sisters, we have to be prepared. The call is now. Over my years, since I was 18, I gathered into Independence and experienced that the Lord wanted me to gather here. And I wanted to play football, I wanted to go to college, I wanted to do all the things that I had in my dreams as a high school kid or as a kid growing up. And the Lord had a different plan, as he always does, unless we're walking in his will. But he brought me here, and he has changed me. And it's only through his son that I was able to be changed. Because there were so many things in my life that I did that were ungodly. There were so many things that I'd stopped from my old life as a high school kid that I'd stopped. And I was like, man, now I'm a good Christian. All my friends are going to see me and they're going to want to convert and they're going to do the godly things. But I realized that it went way more deep than that. That the seeds that I was sowing in my life, the things that I was partaking of in the world, had a spiritual effect. And the vices of the world are only the things that tell us that we have in our hearts. So the seeds that we plant in our hearts, they come out by the ways of the world. So I had a lot of anger. I had a lot of pride. I had a lot of envy, lust, greed. And as I started to evaluate my life over the last 3 years, the Lord changed me. And started to help me in the ways that he wanted me to be, the way that he wanted me to be. And so I'm happy and joyful to say that the Lord has been changing me. And the Lord has changed me. So this morning I want to talk about that change. I want to talk about the goal and the mission that the Lord has for each of us. And how we can reach that goal. Because brothers and sisters, it goes way deeper than what we've thought. Because we are saints, but yet we act like sinners. We live like the world and not like saints. And so all the things that I did in my life started to affect my relationships negatively. I lost a lot of good people in my life because of the things that I didn't realize that the Lord was calling me to repent of. Because in my mind, I thought I had already repented of all the other things that I did in high school, all the lies I told my parents, and all the other things that I did. I wasn't doing those things now. But I didn't realize that the seeds that I had partook of in my life rooted and came out a different way. So as you can see in your life, you may not be doing the things that you did in the time of your old days or the party days or on those times, but those seeds that you sowed in your life may still be there. And how do we get those out? It's only by the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's go to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5 leads it perfectly. Paul calls out a lot of things. And as I read those things, I can see the ungodliness that I sowed in my life that came out in the ways that I acted and how I acted. And this morning, I pray that each of us can be able to reevaluate our life and see how we are still serving Babylon. It's kind of weird to think that our flesh is a part of Babylon. We give into those things because our flesh wants to be a part of this world. And hopefully this morning we can learn the things that the Lord has placed in his word and be perfected. Because as I started to reevaluate, I thought, man, I'm not doing this sin for a very long time. It has been 2 months. But then that next week that I started to think about that, guess what started to happen? I started to desire those things once again. And so, brothers and sisters, as we try to enter the gates of heaven, the gates of Zion, are we going to be able to walk there and enter cleansed with no desire of sin? Because what I realize is that I started to go back, and repentance is fully turning back and never going back. It's fully turning and never picking up what you have laid down at the feet of our Savior. That is true repentance. And I realized that I hadn't done that. And so if I went into the gates of Zion and I said, Lord, I'm ready. I've repented of my sins. For the last 2 months, I have not committed the sin that I've repented of. Would I be ready? Would I be able to stay within the walls of Zion? And I thought to myself, probably not. Because it would be maybe a week, maybe a couple days. Brothers and sisters, Christ told us that you are commanded to be perfect as your Father who is in heaven. How do we become perfect? How do we end the lust, the greed, the pride, the backbiting, the gossip, all the things that Tyler Ramirez had in his life? But since I wasn't doing all the other things that I stopped, I'm good. So brothers and sisters, I hope this morning the Spirit would prick us unto repentance, but unto love. This isn't something that is come. The Lord wants to come down on us, but he wants us to open our eyes and look into a different perspective. Because in the Matthew scripture, it says that where your treasure is, where your heart is, but he says that the eye is the single glory. This heart directs where our eyes look, where our perspectives and our view, our vision is. Our heart directs where we go, unless it is in Christ. Galatians chapter 5, it says, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. And then there's hope in the verses after. And we'll get to that later. But brothers and sisters, in 1830, the Lord restored his church. He restored the priesthood. He restored the ordinances and sacraments that we do partake of. And blessed be the name of the Lord that we can come here, and I can come here from Saints Haven, Missouri, or Sibley, Missouri, and Saints Haven Restoration Branch, that I can come here and be in the same spirit, under the same doctrines, the same baptism. And that's what the Lord desires so much, that we can all be in his kingdom. But restoration is a process. And I've realized that in my life. In the Psalms, David says that the Lord understands our frame. He says, yet we are but the dust of the earth, but the Lord understands our frame. In Matthew, Luke, whatever gospel you want to read, the Lord talks about the sower of seeds. You know, we talk about us being that sower of seeds, to sow the seeds of godliness, to sow the seeds of the gospel, righteousness, love, and peace, and all the other things that Paul lists off in the scriptures that I read after in Galatians. But what we don't realize is, what other seeds do we allow to be sowed in our lives? What things of Babylon are you allowing to be sowed in your life, that you would miss out on the kingdom of Zion? Because Alma tells us that the same spirits that possess us in this life will also possess us in the life to come. And so, brothers and sisters, our Father is the only one that can cleanse us and purify us from those spirits that possess us, those seeds that doth possess us and have us act in an ungodly way. Now, I know each of you, because I know each of my brothers and sisters and your brothers and sisters over at Saints Haven, I guarantee each of you would raise your hand and fulfill a need that somebody needed. That's right, right? Stand up if you wouldn't. I'm just kidding. But I know you would. So you ask, why don't we have Zion yet? Do we love each other? Yeah, we love each other. But brothers and sisters, it's with a dysfunctional love because we have the seeds of the world in our soil. The ways of Babylon, we love the ways of Babylon, the ways that Babylon loves for a temporary time. There's a lot of people that I had a lot of bitterness and unforgiveness towards. And the Lord chastised me because I realized he's trying to tell me, Tyler, don't you understand that these people are on the same team that you are? Don't you understand that they call on my name the same way that you do? You think you're going to walk up into the kingdom and you're going to be East Side Kingdom and they're going to be the West Side Kingdom? No, that's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. Brothers and sisters, this kingdom is way deeper than what we have understood. One of my favorite scriptures, and the last time I used this scripture, someone came to me and told me I should have read it instead of just referenced it. So I'm going to read it this time. Romans chapter 13, verse 14. But put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to gratify the lust thereof. We create provisions in our life that keep us subject to Babylon. We create provisions to satisfy our flesh. What provision are you setting? Is it godly provision? Or provision for your lust, for your flesh, for this world. Yesterday I got one of these really cool phones. Okay? It's an iPhone like 13 or something like that. My last phone was like broken and cracked because didn't learn my lesson, don't have a case or a screen protector on it. But I don't care. I'm gonna get one of those after this, okay, I promise. But yesterday I went into the store. I got this text message, and someone that's on my phone plan with me got the same text message, and they were like, hey, we should really go get some new phones. It's time for an upgrade. And I was like, no, you know what? I my phone works just fine. I don't care about that. He's like, oh, well, you know, I mean, we've had these phones for the last 2 years, and I don't know if you have an iPhone. Well, iPhone, sometimes if you allow it to send you notifications to see how long you've been on your phone, and this isn't to toot my own horn or anything, but brothers and sisters, when we set provision for our Heavenly Father, He will weed out all other things, that we would not be partakers of the lust of our flesh. And so as I looked down at that notification, each week it would go down on the percentage of time of my screen time on the apps that I was on. And I realized that I'm down to like 3%. I don't even pick up this thing. But in my life, after camps and after reunions and after great sermons and after great prayer services and missionary trips, I said, I'm not going to go back to the ways that I was before I started. Preparation isn't a one-time deal, brothers and sisters. Preparation is an everyday thing. I learned that restoration is a process, and it creates longevity. And in the scriptures, that means enduring until the end. Endurance. The scripture says that the hearts of man will fail them. Today is your day to reevaluate your heart. What other things do we set provision for? Do we set the reinforcements in our lives? I'm a behavior interventionist, and at least I'm at school district.
I create behavior plans, behavior success plans, for students K through 6. And with that, behavior plans don't always work. They'll work for a week or a day, and then we have to change them because kids change. Your life changes. Things that may work after a reunion or a camp or a great sermon or a great prayer service or something or a testimony. Don't we forget those things sometimes? It's okay. You can admit it. I do. I remember the spiritual highs that I was on after camps and reunions. I remember the things that the Lord had told me. And then a week later, a month later, I'd go back. It's because I didn't set the provisions for my spiritual life to continue in that same spirit. But I set provision for the lusts of my flesh. Because I found myself going back exactly to the same things that I did. And so when these children, these students are on these behavior plans, what do you think they do? They resort back to chucking the desk at the teacher because that's what they remember they do. Because they went back into that setting. But they have me and my cohort because there's two of us. There needs to be two of us or even more. That provide those times, provide the strategies to remember the testimonies. I have a fifth grader who was really, really terrible. He was on a track to head to maybe in sixth grade. He was probably going to end up in juvenile hall. My cohort, coworker. She's an LDS lady, and as soon as I found that out, we had great discussions. We always talked about the gospel. We always talked about what's coming to the end and what the restoration is doing and what the LDS is doing and how the Lord is moving. And now that fifth grader, because of the godliness, not because of ourselves, but because of the grace of God, the godliness, the standard of that righteousness. I took a picture of his behavior target sheet. Basically, he gets points every day on how well he does or how well he meets his goals. He got a 99%. I was going to cry when he said, "Hey, Mr. Tyler, Mr. Tyler, Mr. Tyler." Well, I did tear up, but I couldn't let him see that I was going to cry. Because he'd be like, "What's going on with you?" I hope to be at 100%. I hope each of us to be at 100%. Nephi says, "You are saved after all that you can do." That means God will make up the rest. If you can only take one step, God will take the million other steps. If you can only pray one word, God will lead you to all the other words. If you can only remember one scripture, God would bring all of the scriptures to your mind. What does that look like in your life? What it looked like in my life was controlling my temper, was controlling me having these prejudices against others. Because as soon as I saw someone stand up or try to provide ministry because I knew what they did, the Lord chastised me. Because as I stand here, I know I've done a lot of things that are ungodly and sinful. And I'm not perfect. But we see so many people being used because God sees each of you as from the beginning. The spiritual beings that are righteous, that have charity, that have love that is unconditional. And that is what charity is. Love unconditional. The perfect love of Christ. That he would cast all of our sins as far as from the east as from the west. That he would forget every ounce of wrong that we have done. And see us as he sees his only begotten Son, even Jesus Christ. whom he was well pleased. You can be just like that. I know your flesh doesn't want to be like that. I know your flesh wants to be fulfilled. I know your mind wants to think the way it wants to think. And Babylon wants us to continue to fall because they know their ending. They know what's going to happen to them. And they want to take us all, as many of us as they can. And so, brothers and sisters, I pray that you hear the word of the Lord today. That you wouldn't subscribe to Babylon's politics. That you wouldn't subscribe to Babylon's lusts. That you wouldn't subscribe to Babylon's ways no longer. The saints of old, when they gathered here, they tried to build their own economy. They tried to make their own businesses. They didn't want to serve Babylon. I pray that we can become like that as well. That we can have Zion bills. I'm just kidding. But that we can be the righteous, the pure in heart. Because Babylon is only temporary. The things that we watch on TV, those seeds make us want to be like them. And you may think, no, that's not how it is. I just like it because it's funny. Oh, I just like it because it's a good show. Oh, I like it because it's a good song. I used to listen to some really vulgar music. A little bit about myself, I'm going to throw it in there. I grew up in an area and around people that fueled my life with things of the world. So if you know a little bit about Snoop Dogg and Ice Cube and Tupac and all those people, yeah, you probably hear a lot of those things that you probably turn off when your kids are in the car. And it wasn't until I got closer and closer and closer to the Lord that those things disgust me. And brothers and sisters, this isn't anything to say that Tyler Ramirez has it all together, because it's not. This week was very, very hard. There were so many things that I was tempted with. But Paul gives us the promise. Paul gives us the answer. He says to put on Christ Jesus, that you won't set provisions for the lusts of your flesh. Put on those godly things. If it has to be VeggieTales you're watching all the time, watch VeggieTales. I'm playing. I mean, if you want to. Brothers and sisters, there's healthy, godly alternatives. Righteous things that we can do. One of my favorite scriptures, and Sarah read it this morning as she was singing. So as soon as I came in here in the song service, like I said, the Spirit has been here, and he is moving, and he is leading us. And it's Romans 14:17. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. And how is it that we receive that Holy Ghost? How is it that we can put on Christ Jesus? How is it that we can dwell in that kingdom? First, we are to repent and be baptized, that then we can have the visitation and receive the Holy Ghost in power. One of my favorite things to throw in a caveat of that is that Zion is only the physical manifestation of the kingdom of God. Because the kingdom of God is a spiritual thing. It's a spiritual kingdom. It teaches us how we are going to live in Zion. He sets it up, righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. It's not meat and drink. It's not the physical things of the world that will save us and have us be led to build Zion. The kingdom is the very foundation of Zion. That there's no poor among us that we love. Righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. The best way that that's listed out on how we should walk in our lives is Moroni. Moroni chapter 8, verse 29. And a lot of you know that scripture, but it's one of my favorite scriptures because in the missionary field, we get to use that scripture. And it helps people understand, and it helps us as saints gauge where our lives are with our Heavenly Father, our relationships with Christ. It says, and the first fruits of repentance is baptism. So if you haven't been baptized, repent and be baptized. And baptism cometh by faith unto the fulfilling of the commandments, and the fulfilling of commandments bringeth remission of sins, and the remission of sins bringeth meekness and lowliness of heart. Cometh the visitation of the Holy Ghost, which comforter filleth with hope and perfect love, which love endureth by diligence unto prayer, until the end come, when all the saints shall dwell with God. Does that not cut it perfect for us? Repent and be baptized in the name of the only begotten Savior, Jesus Christ, that you can be a child of the Lord. And let me give you a little example of this. I see my parents over here. Now, if you look at both of them, you're going to see me and you see them in me. Their very blood is flowing through my very veins. And as I look back as a child and now as an adult, I see that I am my parents. I mean, I'm a little cooler than them, but no, I'm kidding. But I am exactly my parents. What makes you a child of God? It's that very spirit that is within you. That's what says you are his. That is what gains you entrance into the kingdom. You think my parents are going to be like, hey, yo, come on, roll up all the kids. They did. I mean, we had thousands of sleepovers, and they had the whole high school. And I grew up in San Diego, so there was a lot of kids at my high school. God wants to welcome everyone. God is not a respecter of persons. So when we say pray for Ukraine, we need to pray for Russia as well. When we say God bless our troops, we need to say God bless China's troops too. Now you may think, why? Why do we want them to be prayed for? Brothers and sisters, are they not the creation of the God, the Most High God? Do they deserve not a chance at repentance? Are they our enemy? No, they are not. They are this country's enemy. This country is an enemy to God. This world is an enemy to God. How many times has this world failed us? How many times? But we still keep going back. You know what doesn't fail us? The kingdom. And that's why our heart is a little dysfunctional right now. That's why our love is a little dysfunctional right now. Because we have fueled our soil with seeds of this world, that we get angry and passionate, and we build up walls and so many other things that keep us away from being actually in one love and one heart. But I know that you can overcome. I know that we can overcome. Because who overcame? Say his name. Who overcame? Louder than that. Jesus. He overcame so that we can overcome. Brothers and sisters, the things of the world, yes, they have set us up. I am blessed to be an American. I can say I've been to Africa. I've been to all the other foreign lands. And I can say that I am proud to be an American. But that's not where my identity is. One of the toughest things to be is a biracial kid. I am black and I am Mexican, Hispanic. Now in California, those two people don't get along in neighborhoods. Those two races don't get along. And so I had a battle in my life, a war in my life. I'm trying to understand who I was and where my identity lies. Am I black? Am I Hispanic? Well, I'm both, but that's not my identity. My identity is in my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. My culture is the kingdom. My culture isn't Mexican culture. My culture isn't black culture. My culture is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. Amen. So, brothers and sisters, where is your identity? You know, there's a lot of things that occupy our time. And I understand everybody has their own life and their own purposes. But brothers and sisters, the bare minimum can't be done. It's not it. It's not going to work. We have so many things that beset us and keep us busy. Oh, well, I have to take my kids to soccer. I have to go to see this concert. Oh, I have to do these things and do that thing. Well, brothers and sisters, you better be the best godly father and mother, and your children better know about their Savior. Your homes better be righteous, where there is no unclean thing dwelling. You have to work? Well, you better be the godliest doctor, that all of your patients had an experience with the Spirit that you carried. There's no more time for excuses. Work, family, friends, anything of this world. It's all about our mindset and where our heart is. If our mindset is for the kingdom, then in our families, in our workplaces, with our friends, at restaurants, we would be sowing the seeds of the kingdom. And how do we do that? How do we do that? First, we take care of what's going on in here. Re-evaluate. Ask the Lord to open your spiritual eyes and ask Him, what is keeping you from Him? Because the promise is clean. The promise is clear and true. He says, draw nigh unto me, and I'll draw nigh unto thee. Come unto me, and I will perfect you. What things have we been giving into? I'm not saying the physical manifestations that Paul was talking about. I'm talking about the spiritual effect, the seeds that are in our hearts. That is what the Lord is most concerned about. That our hearts would not fail us. Because we have the heart of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. One of my first missionary trips was to Nauvoo, Illinois. Nauvoo is a special place. I think I was about 18 or 19. And I was traveling with one of my best friends, Josh Pedersen. And once we went into, I don't know if you've ever been to Nauvoo, but when you go into Nauvoo, there's people everywhere. Usually LDS friends. There's a lot of people out on the streets because it's like the center, right? It's the only thing that's really there in that area. And I say that because I come from a big city and that's all that's there. And so we had prepared to go out and talk to each of these people. And try to see if we can bring them to the fullness of the gospel, or at least somehow be able to connect, have relationships and connect ties and stuff like that with each other. But as we unpacked and kind of got everything ready, we went out into that square. You know what happened? There was absolutely no one on the streets or outside other than this Baptist dude. That was like, the Book of Mormon is false, these Mormons are false, and everything. So we had a pretty funny conversation with him for about an hour. But we still wanted to share the gospel with anyone that we came in contact with. So after we left with him, We got this idea to just walk down the road, just to walk down the highway. And if you've ever been to Nauvoo, there's just one highway, just goes forever. I don't know what it's called, but it was just a highway. And we kept walking and walking, and our idea was that there was going to be someone in the car that would be nice to pick up two slightly overweight guys walking in the middle of summer. And we were going to share the gospel with them because the doors were locked, the car was moving, the windows were probably up because the AC was on. So there was no way they could get us out of their hair because they had to listen to us until they took us to the next city that we were going to. But that didn't happen. Being from San Diego, I didn't get to see a lot of livestock or wildlife like you guys do. Like when I first started to see so many squirrels just running around like seagulls, I was like, oh my goodness, that's a squirrel. There's squirrels. Like I was a dog, like a squirrel. You know, I literally was. So whenever I started to come around like the more rural areas and I saw cows, I would honk my horn to see if they'd look at me and notice me. Okay, I'm from San Diego. Come on, guys, give me a break, okay? We don't have cows just chilling in our backyards. So as we came up, there was this farm. And this farm of maybe 20 horses. And they took notice of us. It was the most beautiful thing that has ever happened to me. Well, there's a lot of other beautiful things, but this is one of them. As we were walking, I was like, hey, Josh, look at all those horses over there. They're so close, we can go over and pet them. He's like, dude, if we go over and pet someone else's horses, you're in the wrong part of town. If you go on someone's property and touch their things, it's not going to be nice. And I said, all right, man, you know this place better than I do, right? Okay, so I was like, all right. What happened next was so beautiful. The horses looked at us, and then they ran. And as soon as they stopped, we'd catch up to where they were. And then they took off and ran again. And then we'd catch up to them, and they'd stop. And I was like, Josh, I think they want us to come over and talk to them. I think they want us. They want us to come over there. He's like, all right, fine, this is actually pretty cool. So Josh is like, all right, let's go over. Had to push him first because, you know, he's from around here. He's like, Josh, go over first. We go over these horses. There's a scripture in the scriptures, in the Bible, where Jesus says to preach the gospel unto every creature. So you know what my goofy self did? I started to preach the gospel to these horses. And after I had said something, I said, can I get an amen or hallelujah? And five of those horses raised on their back hind legs and shot a nay. And the Spirit bore witness. Brothers and sisters, they're subject to our Father who is in heaven. Oh, how I long to be like those horses that knows my heavenly Father. That any time the Spirit is brought to me, I know that same exact Spirit. Is that not what you want? Is that not what you want to be? He says his house has many mansions. Are you tired? I'm tired. My job makes me tired. Is that what you want? Or do you want what's coming for Babylon? The destruction, the trials, the tribulation. Oh, you best believe there's going to be some trial and tribulation design. If you don't think so, then we might be a little behind. We have to work. But it all starts on where our heart is. Is your heart, is your treasure in this world, in this Babylon, or is it in the kingdom of God? Jesus says the kingdom of God has already come nigh unto you. It doesn't come by observation. You can't say it's here, it's there. Brothers and sisters, we are the kingdom of God. We are those citizens. But right now, we're just a little bit off, aren't we? How do we love the way that God loves? And you know, you've probably been to many weddings, many sermons you've heard about charity. But I want to read this because last time I've referenced a scripture like this, I've always been like, you should have read it all. So let's turn to Corinthians chapter 13, 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We're going to read just verse 4 through 8. Now, if my love isn't like this, then we have to go back to repentance. It says, charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth it not itself, is not puffed up, doth not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Charity never fails. Oh, I know, because I have prejudices. And the Lord has opened my mind. Do I look at my brothers or sisters with that prejudice? Or do I believe that in their moment, when they had asked or answered to serve in that capacity, or asked to serve or answered to serve when to share a testimony or sing a song or whatever, am I believing that they had a conversation with God and that God has called them to do that? Or are we holding those grudges and bitterness and prejudices in our minds and our hearts? What else? Hopeth all things. Where's our hope? Is our hope that the priesthood of the church is going to lead us to be able to change our hearts and minds? Yeah, we're going to do that, but you have to answer that call. What else? What else is charity? There's so many things that we have to look back into our hearts and our lives to see, is this the type of love that we have? Charity endureth all things. Are we capable of enduring until Zion can be brought out of heaven and meet us because we have established that spiritual and physical place that they can come down and be with us? That all the world might see and partake? Because I've been to those foreign lands. You have many people that have been in those foreign lands where there's war. Where there's hurt, even in our own soil, even in your own lives. Isaiah tells us that righteousness worketh peace. Righteousness worketh peace. So the fruit of our righteousness carries over and creates peace. That we can have no war among us. That we can see eye to eye. But it starts with the righteousness that's within our hearts. The love that's within our hearts. And it starts back with the R word. Repentance. What seeds are you allowing to be sowed into your life? That will withhold you from entering into the gates of Zion. Isaiah chapter 40. It says, comfort ye my people, saith your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished and that her iniquity is pardoned. For she hath received the Lord's hand double for all her sins. The voice of him that crieth. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness. Prepare ye the way. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Preparation is an everyday thing. Are you prepared? Are we preparing for Zion to come? Are we preparing to be a part of Zion? Or are we preparing for our 401ks? Are we preparing for what we will have in the end so that we can sit back and just chill in our retirement? not saying don't go work. Oh yeah, we got to work. I'm not saying don't get a job. But Proverbs says, commit thy ways unto the Lord, and you shall be established. Zion will be established if we commit all our ways with our husbands, our wives, our children, ourselves, our jobs. That's how we prepare, is by sowing the seeds of righteousness in others' lives, because we have those same righteous seeds in our garden. Jesus says that the kingdom of God is likened unto a tree that is planted, that the birds and all will come and partake off the fruit that it bears. Are you that tree? We got some branches that are falling off a little bit. Brothers and sisters, the call is now. The time is now to set provision for the kingdom in our lives. No longer given to the ways of the world. No longer given to the ways of Babylon, because it shall fall. And if you give in to those, you shall fall. But we have hope, don't we? We have a lot of joy because we've seen the victory. We know the victory. We know that we are citizens of the kingdom. And I know that each of you have a heart that is dear unto the Lord. So I'm not saying that y'all are bad people. I'm not saying that I'm a bad person. The Lord just wants us to switch our vision. Switch what we've been doing. And fully come out of the world. He says, you can't serve two masters, for you will hate one and love the other. Do you find yourself sometimes just being so overwhelmed with, oh man, here goes another one. Oh man, I don't want to go to church tonight. Oh man, I don't think I want to go to prayer service. That's because that's the inward battle that we are facing. Because we are trying to walk a line with 2 feet on both sides, kind of like this. It's kind of weird, huh? You're trying to walk like that? That's kind of weird. I know if somebody's walking like that, ooh, what's wrong with them? But that's what we're kind of looking like spiritually. Kind of looking a little weird. We're not looking like our Savior. And I don't get it right every time. I play softball with Tyler Heyman, and sometimes I'm ready. Those guys are ready to go at our team, and I'm like, first one, like, oh, y'all want to step up? Come on. That's not how I should be. And I try, and I ask the Lord to come and change me. And there are days that Tyler Ramirez is really meek, self-control, and I'm working at it. But I know who I'm working at it with. And he has overcome. So I shall overcome. But is Tyler listening to the songs that put me in that state of, hey, yo, let's go? Is Tyler watching the TV shows or the movies that lead me to other things? So reevaluate on what seeds you are planting in your heart this day. I'm going to leave you with a scripture this morning. I know I went over. Sorry. One thing about me, I love to talk, but I don't. Moroni chapter 9, verse 6. It says, and now, my beloved son, notwithstanding their hardness, let us labor diligently. For if we should cease to labor, we should be brought under condemnation. For we have a labor to perform whilst in the tabernacle of clay, that we may conquer the enemy of all righteousness and rest our souls in the kingdom of God. And Moroni chapter 10, verse 28 and 29. It says, awake and arise from the dust, O Jerusalem, yea, and put on thy beautiful garments, O daughter of Zion. And strengthen thy stakes, and enlarge thy borders forever, that thou mayest no more be confounded, that the covenants of the eternal Father which hath made unto thee, O house of Israel, may be fulfilled. Yea, come unto Christ, and be perfected in him, and deny yourselves of all ungodliness, and if ye shall deny yourselves of all ungodliness, and love God with all your might, mind, and strength, then is his grace sufficient for you, that by his grace you may be perfect in Christ. And if by the grace of God you're perfect in Christ, ye can in no wise deny the power of God. If we have that same spirit, the spirit that we cannot deny that he is God, then what do you think the world will see? That same spirit that will not allow them to deny that he is their creator and he sent his only begotten son to die and resurrect that we may have this grace and be perfect as he who is in heaven. Thank you.
We'll be standing together to continue our worship with Redeemer of Israel.
Pray with me. Our most gracious and heavenly Father, we're so pleased that your spirit has been with us in abundance this morning. Our cups runneth over, Father. We thank you for this beautiful day, and we thank you for the words that were your words that were brought through our brother Tyler. Father, if we can take these words into our heart and embed them in our heart and look to you and have that desire in our heart to follow you all our days, every day, all the time, to practice our love for you. And we know that you loved us first. and you love us greatly. And so, Father, we just pray that we can use that love that you give us and return it to you first, and then to each and every one we come into contact with, Father. Because these are the greatest two commandments. And so, Father, we're just thankful for this morning, the cleansing rain, your voice, your thunderous voice, being able to hear that. And Father, we're thankful for this weekend, for the revival, for the speakers that were here the last couple days. And Father, also at this time, I'd like to offer a blessing on the food that we're about to partake of that'll strengthen and nourish our bodies, that we will be strong soldiers for you, strong servants for you, that we will share you with everybody we come in contact with. And not for our glory, for Father, we give you all the glory. We love you, Father. And we pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
I stand between you and lunch, so I'll be quick. A couple of announcements. Thanks to all those that assisted in the revival that we had this weekend. I was going to try and decide which one of the seven sermons I was going to recommend to you, but I would recommend all seven because they were wonderful. They're on our website. If you didn't get a chance to be with us, we were blessed. Prayer walk this Saturday, the 21st at 9. Join us for the prayer walk. Our 24-hour prayer is coming up. We've got three openings. Please sign up for an opening for our 24-hour prayer. In your bulletin, you have registration for Zion's Ridge Reunion. You're all invited to attend that. And Elsie was telling me just before I came up here that if you don't have time to go out during the day, the classes are wonderful. Some of the classes I was at last year at Zion's Ridge were wonderful. If you can't be there during the day, come out in the evenings. You see in the bulletin who's going to be speaking. They'll be wonderful. Priesthood meeting this Thursday. I pray that the priesthood will join us. We're going to have a special discussion at 7 o'clock this Thursday. Sherry, do you want to join me? Sherry has a couple of announcements she'd like to make, and then I'll have one more. Ladies, if you haven't gotten involved with our women's department, they're doing wonderful things. They're doing God's work. So I invite you to join them. Finally, the first week of May was Teacher Appreciation Week, but we've had some things. We had a joint communion service, and then we had Mother's Day, so we decided that we would wait until today to recognize our teachers in this branch. Our teachers have started a tsunami of the Spirit in this branch. In our children, just look around you and see all the children that have joined us, and that's because of the work that our teachers are doing. And so we want to recognize their work today just in a small way. First of all, the sister that's in charge of our youth Sunday school classes, Sister Sherry. She's done a wonderful job. She meets with our teachers often, assures herself that what our kids are getting are what she wants them to be getting. She's doing a wonderful job, and you can tell that from the growth. Sister Sherry, would you come up? Let's hear it for our sister. Zach Wilson, I think, is preaching elsewhere today, so he's not going to be here. He's our adult Sunday school director, and you can see the work that he's done. Sister Helen Brown. Helen, she's probably back in the kitchen working on. Helen, come forward. Preschool and kindergarten teacher. Your hands clean? Julie Bettler. Preschool, kindergarten, pre-baptismal class, and junior church helper. She just got out of pre-baptismal class.
Yeah, it is. Awesome.
Isaiah Peterson, preschool and kindergarten class. These people are dedicated. I think I mentioned a couple weeks ago. Thank you, brother. If you haven't had a chance to go up and just sneak up sometime and see our kids in their classes, they have wonderful crafts and scriptural lessons every week. Sister Dawn Peterson, our primary class. Got a lot of people involved. Sister Mary Fields. Our primary class. Rebecca Cornish, junior and senior high. She just got her new classroom today. Praise the Lord. Mary Jo Staten, pre-baptismal class. I don't forget everybody. Almost everybody's been involved. Sister Becky Staten. Kingdom Kids. Is Becky here? Okay, she was, but she's not now. Becky Staten. Margaret Fountain, Junior Church. Joe Fountain, Junior Church. I think you had his name, Troy Lassen. He's on here. He's not here. He teaches our juniors. He was here. Oh, he is here. Been teaching our juniors faithfully. I appreciate it. I want to express appreciation to all those teachers. Our Sunday school is wonderful and has been wonderful. If you know anybody that wants to bring their kids to our Sunday school class, that gets them into our congregation, and we invite them all. It's high-quality stuff, and adults as well. God bless. Enjoy your lunch.